So now we are going to move forward, and we are going to move to the next topic, which is called identity-aware graph neural networks. Right. So in the previous part of the lecture, we talked about how does the node encode its position in the network? How does the node know where in the network the node is? Now, in the second part, we are going to develop a more expressive graph neural network that is going to take care of all these different symmetries that can appear in the network and in the underlying graph, and it will make the graph neural network more expressive. So what we have learned so far is that classical GNNs would fail for position-aware tasks. And we said, let's use anchors to improve graph neural network performance on position-aware tasks. Now we are going to switch back and focus more on structure-aware tasks and say, can GNNs perform perfectly on structure-aware tasks? And as we have seen before, the answer here is unfortunately no. And the issue is that GNNs exhibit kind of three levels of failure cases in structure-aware tasks. And I'm going to show you some, you know, failure cases. And of course, all these failure cases are kind of worst-case scenarios that are very intricate in a sense that due to the symmetries, the GNN is going to fail. So perhaps they don't necessarily appear in practice too often, but they may appear in some parts of the data, and they are still very useful to study. So here is the first failure case. This is for the node-level tasks. Imagine you want to do a node-level classification, you want to do node-level prediction. Here, different inputs from the same, basically different inputs, but the same computational graph will result in the same embedding. So if I have these two nodes, V1 and V2, you know, residing in these types of connected components, as we said before, their computational graphs, if you work it out, are exactly the same because they have two neighbors and each of their neighbors has two neighbors and so on and so forth. So this means that these nodes V1 and V2 will be embedded into exactly the same point in the embedding space, and we won't be able to assign them different labels. Now, the same type of things can happen also, for example, for link prediction, where, for example, you can have this type of input graph and you want to decide whether, you know, V0 should link to V1 or should it link to V2. And again, if you look at the computation graphs, the computation graphs are the same, so nodes V1 and V2 are going to have the same embedding. And because they have the same embedding, the neural network will give the same probability to edge A as well as to edge B. And perhaps that is not the most realistic. So that's a failure case, again, for a different type of input graph. And then, you know, for graph-level tasks, there are also well-known failure cases, because different input graphs will still result in the same graph neural network based embedding. Why is that the case? Is because if you, for example, in these types of networks, all the nodes have the same degree. But you notice that these two graphs are different because here the nodes link to exactly the immediate nodes. Here the nodes link kind of a bit farther out. But if you look at the computation graphs, the two computation graphs will be the same. So again, these two entire graphs will get the same embedding. So again, this is a very kind of highly symmetric input graph, but still, these two graphs are different, they are non-isomorphic, but you know, this is kind of a corner case for WL test, and it is also a corner case for graph neural networks. So here, again, graph neural network without any useful node features will always classify nodes A and B or graphs A and B into the same position, into the same class. So now, how are we going to resolve this? What is the big idea here? And the big idea in this second part of the lecture is that we can assign color to the node we want to embed. And that's why we call this identity-aware, because the neural network, as we unroll it, will know what is the starting node, what is the node where we started. So the idea is, If I want to embed node v1, I'm going to color it. And if I go, and because I'm going to give it a color, I'm now the graph, the computational graph will be different because I will remember whenever I unroll the computational graph, I will remember the color of this colored node. Right? So this means that now our computational graph will remember whenever it hits the node of interest v1. So it will have these colors. And you know why is this useful? This is useful because it is inductive, right? It is invariant to the node ordering or identities of the nodes, because the only node we color is the node where we start, and then we just look how often does this node where we start appear in the computation graph, right? So eventually, right, like if our graph is connected, As we go deeper into more layers of a graph neural network, there will be some cycle that will lead us back to the starting node, and we will remember that and have that node colored in the computation graph as well. And the important point here is because the node coloring is inductive, even though I have these two, let's say, different input graphs, but I have labeled or numbered the nodes differently, right? I have 1, 2, 3 versus 1, 2, 3. The underlying computational graphs will be the same, which is good because they don't change under permuting the IDs or identities of the node. So this is a great feature to have because it means our models are able to generalize better. So let's now talk more about this inductive capability of node coloring, and let's look at a node level task. And the point is that this inductive node coloring helps us with node classification tasks. For example, I have here the case we have already looked at before. I have the node on a triangle, I have a node on a square, I color the root, and now I say let's create the computation graphs. Here I create the computation graphs, and you very quickly see that the computation graphs are quite different. And in particular, they become different at the bottom level, where in the part B here, at when I go two hops out, I only hit these nodes, while in the first case, I actually go and hit again the starting node. So now these two computation graphs are different because we also consider colors. So we will be able to successfully differentiate between nodes V1 and nodes V2. So this is a very elegant solution to this problem that where a classical graph neural network would fail. And similarly, we can do the same thing for graph classification, right? If I take my two input graphs, the way I create the embedding of the graph is to create an embedding of nodes and then aggregate those. So if I look at node-specific computation graphs, structurally they might be the same, but because I have labeled the starting node, and now I know whenever my computation graph returns back to the starting node, you notice that now the coloring pattern between these two graphs is different. These two nodes is different, which means their embeddings will be different, which means that when we aggregate embeddings, the embeddings for the graphs will be different, which means we'll be able to take these two input graphs A and B and embed them into different points and assign them different classes. So this is exactly what we want. And then, you know, for edge level tasks, again, if, you know, I start with V0 and I say, you know, I want to assign a different probability to nodes to the edges A and B, I can say what will be the embedding of V1 here, what will be embedding of V2, and I see that their corresponding computation graphs will be different because V1 is going to hit V0 sooner than V2. So here the point is that when I'm embedding nodes for link prediction, I'm given a pair of nodes, and here I'm going to color both nodes, the left node and the right node. And this way, I'll be able to distinguish the two computational graphs. So this means it will allow us to assign a different probability to the node, to the edge A versus the edge B, which is what we want. So what I have demonstrated so far is that this node coloring, where we color the identity of the starting node, or in link prediction of both nodes involved in the link prediction task, allows us to differentiate and distinguish these types of symmetric corner cases that make classical neural network graph neural networks fail. So now the question is, how do you build a GNN that uses this node coloring and that it will allow us to distinguish these different colored computation graphs? The idea is the following, and the model is called identity-aware graph neural network. And what we want to do is we want to utilize inductive node coloring in the embedding computation. And the key idea is that we want to use heterogeneous message passing, right? Normally in a GNN, we apply the same message aggregation computation to all the children in the computation graph, right? So whenever we are aggregating and transforming messages, we apply the same aggregation and the same neural network operator, right? So this is what we classically do. In a graph neural identity-aware graph neural network, we are going to do heterogeneous message passing. So we are going to use different types of aggregation, different types of message passing applied to different nodes based on their color. So it means that in an IDGNN, we are going to use different message and aggregation functions for nodes with different colors. So it means that, for example, whenever we are aggregating into a color node, we are going to use one type of transformations and message passing operator, and whenever we are aggregating into a non-colored node, we are going to use a second type of aggregation and transformation. So this means that in a given layer, different message and aggregation functions will be used to nodes based on the color of the node. And this is the key, right? Because if the node knows its color and it can use a different aggregator, this means that the message will get transformed differently, which means the final results will be different depending on whether the nodes with colors were involved in aggregation versus nodes without colors being involved in aggregation. So, you know, why does this heterogeneous message passing work, right? Suppose that two nodes, V1 and V2, have the same computational graph structure, but they have different node coloring, right? And since we apply different neural network embedding computation, right, different message passing and different aggregation, right, we have different parameters for nodes with one color versus the nodes with the other color, this means that the final result will be different. And this means that the final output, the final embedding between V1 and V2 is going to be different. So, you know, what is the key difference between GNN and identity-aware GNN? If we look at this, this example we have looked so far, if I have nodes V1 and V2, want to distinguish them, in the classical GNN computation, the two computation graphs are the same, all the nodes are the same, there is no differentiating node features, so the aggregations across these two trees will be the same, so we won't be able to distinguish A and B. In the case when we actually color the starting node, and now the two computation graphs are different, so all we have to account for now that is that when we aggregate the information from the from the leaves to the root of the graph neural network, that this information about the color is preserved or somehow accounted for, so that the final message will have a different value depending on one versus the other. And this is exactly the case what is happening, and this is why IDGNN allows us to make this distinction. Another thing to think about it, what is IDGNN really doing? IDGNN is really counting cycles of different lengths starting at a given root node, right? So if I start here, IDGNN will now able to count or realize that there is a cycle of length 3, right? So here, this is now basically a cycle. You go from yourself to the neighbor, and then to another neighbor, and you come back to the node, right? So this is a cycle of 3 hops. While in this case, graph neural network is going to realize that this is a cycle of length 4, because you have to go to the node, to the neighbor, to the first neighbor, to the second neighbor, to the third neighbor, and from here you only arrive to the starting node itself, right? So here the computational graph will be able to capture that or be able to compute that node is part of a cycle of length 4, but no cycles of length 3, while here this will be able to capture that the node is part of a cycle of length 3, but not, let's say, 4. So this is what IDGNN is able to do. It's able to count cycles, and it's able to learn and count them through the message passing of the graph neural network. So how do you do this now? So as I said, one is to use heterogeneous message passing. And the second way how you can do this is that we can, based on the intuition we have just proposed, you can also use a simplified version of the IDGNN, where basically the idea is to include identity information as an augmented node feature and sidestep the heterogeneous node message passing. And the idea here is basically you can augment the node feature by using the cycle counts in each layer as an augmented node feature, and then apply a simple GNN, right? So basically you want to use cycle counts in each layer as an augmented feature for the root node, and then simply apply homogeneous message passing, basically drop the colors, right? So the idea would be that every node gets now gets a description that simply says how many cycles of length 0 are you part of, how many cycles of length 2, cycles of length 3, and so on. And this way you will be able to distinguish the node, the two computational graphs, and be able to distinguish the two nodes into two different classes. So let's summarize the identity-aware graph neural networks. This is a general and powerful extension to graph neural network framework. It makes graph neural networks more expressive. The IDGNN, this idea of inductive node coloring and heterogeneous message passing, can be applied to any graph neural network architecture, meaning graph convolutional neural network, graph sage, gene, so graph isomorphism network, and any other architecture. And IDGNN will provide a consistent performance gain in many node level as well as edge and graph level tasks, because it allows us to break the symmetries and allows us to basically identify how the node belongs to different cycles. This means that IDGNNs are more expressive than their classical graph neural network counterparts. And this means that IDGNN is kind of the simplest model that is more expressive than one WL test. And it can be easily implemented because it's basically just you color the root node, and that's all the information you need to worry about. So this is quite cool because it allows us now to distinguish this node on a triangle versus node on a square. This was the first, and the key idea is here to have this inductive node coloring. And then we also talked about position-aware graph neural networks, where the idea is that you want to distinguish the position of the node in the graph. And the key idea there was to use the notion of anchors and characterize the location, the position of the node, by the location, by the distance of the node to the anchors. And we talked about we want to have anchors of different sizes, and we want to have a lot of anchors of size 1. We want to have a lot fewer anchors of size 2, even fewer of size 4, and so on and so forth. And the distance of a node to the anchor is the distance of the node to any node that is part of this anchor or anchor set.